Pretty weak voice. Okay, good. Yeah, I'm going to talk today about ground motion prediction equations, and this is the William B. Joyner lecture for 2014. And so some of this material may be familiar with you, or some of it may be you're wondering why I'm even talking about it. But I should talk a little bit about the I know this is going to work. It did work before. Let me see. Oh, okay, there we go. Interesting. This lecture series was named after a very close colleague of mine, Bill Joyner. And if your people are all too young probably to have run across Bill's name, but he was very very active in the interface between seismology and earthquake engineering. He's very well known. He died of cancer, and as a result, I mean, it's not as a result, obviously, but we decided to have a memorial fund set up for him. And what we do is every year there's a Joyner lecturer who's chosen. I was certainly not the first one. My lecture was in 2014, and that's the lecture I'm going to give to you today. I'm going to, first of all, give you proper credit, because if you've read any of my previous publications, you'll see that my name is first. I'm first author on a number of those, and they shouldn't have been, but we'll get there. Then I'm going to spend a lot of time talking about what ground motion predictions are, about the basics of the things. I'm going to cover a lot of material. And then finally, I'll talk about how they're used in building codes, in particular, how they're used in coming up with something they call a hazard curve, and how that's used in constructing hazard maps and design maps. But first of all, to give proper credit, one of the series of papers that is probably most best known to many people is Boore, Joyner, and Fumal, published in 93, 94, and 97. I'm first author on that, but in fact, Bill should have been the first author, and I can tell you why. He invented the distance measure, which we're going to be using in the equations, and I'll go into more detail of what that measure is. Luckily, it's known as R sub JB rather than BJ, so he's getting proper credit for that. He thought of using a shear wave velocity averaged over a 30-meter depth as a continuous site response variable. More on this later. He recognized that data censoring due to non-triggers of operational instruments could bias the attenuation in the equations. He devised a procedure, we call it a two-stage regression procedure, which is very similar to modern statistics they call mixed effects or random effects modeling. He wrote and ran the computer programs for doing the regression. He wrote the papers, the reports, and the paper. So why he wanted me as first author is beyond me. But anyway, now I sort of have come clean, and I've given this lecture a number of different places, so people probably know that I shouldn't be given credit as first author. But with that, let's move into what are prediction equations. They're simply equations that allow you to predict some measure of ground shaking as a function of a fairly small set of explanatory variables. And the most common ones, as we'll get into it, are magnitude and distance and something about the site. And what the equations will allow you to do, if we're given magnitude, like in this case 7.3 and a strike slip type earthquake and a VS30 of 255, they allow you to predict, in this case I'm showing peak acceleration, the mean peak acceleration, and then something about the distribution of that. That's very important. The distribution about the mean is very important in constructing hazard maps, as we'll see. How are they used? Well, obviously they're used in engineering, because if an engineer wants to know what's the ground shaking going to be, say I know that there's an earthquake of magnitude 7.5 at 10 kilometers or 20 kilometers away, they have to have a number for the design. And if it's a critical structure, you know, it's just a number and maybe the statistical distribution and the uncertainty of that number. But it's also used in building codes. And something that probably isn't appreciated as much is that these equations are very useful in seismology, even if you're not an engineer, because they give you a very nice summary of how ground motion depends on source scaling, source effects and path effects and site effects. They require lots of different things. When I first got into this game, I thought it was really kind of a boring field, you know, coming up with equations predicting ground motions. But in fact, it requires knowledge of a lot of different disciplines, all the way from how do you acquire the data and process the data, all the way to how do you do the statistical regression analysis. So it's really been a fun thing to work in, a fun field to work in. How are they derived? Well, the first thing you need to do is collect data, and that's a really big part of the whole problem. And then you have to choose functions that you're going to fit to that data. You have to do the regression fit. Then you have to look at the residuals to see if there are any obvious trends that you that would require you to revise the functions. And this is model building. It's not just curve fitting, because sometimes the equations that we're using, we can't determine all the coefficients in the equations just from the data because we don't have enough data. So we have to use results from simulations to fit some of the coefficients, and then we use regression to fit some of the others. Considerations for the form of the functions. My own philosophy is similar to Einstein's here, as simple as possible, but not simpler. You can come up with very, very involved, complicated equations, and you could probably fit every piece of data, but it's not going to be very useful in predicting future motions. Those equations do have to give you reasonable predictions in places that are data poor, but engineering important, in particular close to large earthquakes where we don't have much data. And we're finding now more and more that using simulations to guide both the form of the functions and some of the coefficients is very important. And I think as time is going on, we're going to find more and more simulations being used as people get confidence in those to predict the ground motions in places where we don't have observed data, and then incorporating those simulated motions into the observed motions to come up with revised sets of equations. So what do we want to predict? Well, the intensity measures we want to predict generally are peak velocity, peak acceleration, and response spectra. And I'll talk in some detail about what is the response spectra. It may be a foreign concept to you, or maybe you're very familiar with it. The predictor or explanatory variables, the common ones, the three common ones, are some measure of the earthquake size, the distance from the earthquake to the site, and some way of characterizing the local site geology. And additional predictor variables that are in modern equations very often are the depth of or thickness of sedimentary basins, whether you're above a dipping fault, like particularly a rupture, a thrust fault, or a reverse fault, the depth of the top of the rupture, and so on. So there are many other variables that we are starting to put into the equations. Before doing that, though, let's talk about the wave types and frequencies of most importance for earthquake engineering. For the horizontal shear wave motions are the most important. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but generally we have P waves, which are waves that if the wave is traveling like this, the motion is going like that. It's compressional, it's in rarefaction. And the shear waves, if the wave is going like that, are going back and forth like this. It's the shear wave motions that are most important. And the reason for that is that, first of all, earthquakes generally radiate more shear wave energy than P wave energy. So the most dominant energy in the seismogram is going to be the shear wave. And then secondly, as the waves propagate to the surface of the Earth, the lower velocities of the surface of the Earth cause, because of refraction and Snell's law, it causes the waves to turn, the rays to turn up, and the shear energy is going from maybe like this to be more or less horizontal. And buildings are weakest in a horizontal direction, weakest to horizontal shaking. So all those things come together to mean that the shear waves on horizontal components are generally the most important. In terms of the frequencies, generally 20 hertz to about 10 seconds. And the reason for this is that a very simple rule of thumb is that the resonant period of a typical n-story building is simply n divided by 10. I have no idea how tall this building is here, like three stories or something like that. Yeah, so the resonant period may be on the order of a third of a second, something like that. And it turns out there's a lot of energy and ground shaking in that frequency range, in this frequency range from 20 hertz to 10 seconds. So we have a combination of the ground shaking has frequency content that is in the range of the resonant periods of the structures, so that that's why earthquakes are very important for structures, structural response. So what are the most common measure that we're now using in ground motion prediction equations is we call the response spectra. It's nothing more than the maximum response of a suite of single degree of freedom oscillators to a given input shaking. It's useful because buildings can be often represented in a very simple way as a single degree of freedom oscillator with a damping of about 5%. That's just a very rough rule of thumb. But let me show you how these response vectors are actually computed. So let's consider a two-story building right here. And if we put in at the base, two stories, so that the rule of thumb said that the resonant period is about 0.2 seconds. So we put into the computer, we did a simulation where we put that motion, that acceleration is input, and this is the actual output of the oscillator right here, 0.2 second oscillator. If we consider a bit longer period building, 0.5 and 1 second, so a five-story building and a 10-story building, and we put the exact same ground motion in at the base, you can see that the output that we get is quite different. Obviously, the very long period oscillator is going to have, because of the resonance, it's going to pick out of this input time series, input acceleration, essentially shaking that has a 1 second period. That's going to be the output. If you then pick off the peak response for every one of those oscillators, and you plot that peak versus the period of the oscillator, like this, and then you do it for all possible periods, so we have a whole continuum of oscillators, you come up with this curve. This is called the response spectrum. And it's useful because if you knew that you had a structure whose period was, say, right in here, then this curve tells you what the response would be for that structure to that particular input motion. So when we analyze data for these equations, we take every accelerogram that we get, and we compute the response spectra for a whole suite of vibration periods, and then we tabulate those, and then we do that for every recording we have, and then eventually that's the basic data set that we're using in coming up with equations. So this is an illustration of why peak acceleration, which is still commonly used, and it was very commonly used in the past, is probably not a good measure of ground shaking. These are all real seismograms, real acceleration records from four different earthquakes of very different magnitudes at different parts of the world, different distances, but they all happen to have the same peak acceleration. You can see that the waveforms are quite different. This is actually the Michoacan earthquake in Mexico in 1985, magnitude 8 earthquake at 400 kilometers recorded in Mexico City. You can see it has it's almost monochromatic. It has a very strong resonance because of the site response in the lake bed in Mexico City. And this one, for example, is a 7.5. That's a big earthquake, but it's 183. But it has much higher frequency motions. It was probably recorded on harder material. But they all have the same peak acceleration. If you plot the response vector from all of those, you can see that they all come together at very short period, which is a necessary property of an oscillator. But once you go to longer periods, you see there's a tremendous range of variation. And so the peak acceleration would not be a good measure of the overall ground shaking for this suite of records. Okay, so that's what we're trying to measure. We call it the ground motion intensity measure. What do we use for the basic predictor variables? Well, magnitude is the basic measure of a size of an earthquake, and I'm sure you've all heard about that. There are many kinds of magnitudes. The magnitudes that almost everyone uses today are called moment magnitude. And I won't go into a lot of detail. I won't go into any detail of how it's computed, other than to say it's the best single measure of earthquake size because it does not saturate. So if you have a really huge earthquake, its moment magnitude will be much larger than a smaller earthquake. I should have put in a slide of this, but there was the 1906 earthquake in California that was about a magnitude. It's actually a little bit, there's controversy about what the magnitude is, but about 8 something. And then there was the Chile earthquake in 1960, whose surface wave magnitude was similar to that of the 1906 earthquake, but it was much, much larger. And its moment magnitude was, instead of 7.7, was like 9.6, so it was huge. And what I should have put in was a map of the rupture surface of those two overlaid on the kind of turned up horizontally and put on a map of the outline of the state of California. And you can see that the 1960 earthquake covered almost the whole state, whereas the 1906 earthquake was very narrow. So anyway, moment magnitude is gets away from those problems, and that's what's being used. What about distance? This is something that, again, there is not really any consensus on exactly what distance to use, but when you think about a rupture in an earthquake, it's never just a point, especially with large earthquakes. It occurs over some dimensions, spatial dimensions. So that red is looking down into the earth, a perspective view, and you can see that this is, say, the rupture surface. The rupture always starts at one place, which we call the hypocenter, and then it ruptures at a velocity of about 2 kilometers a second away from that point. But there might be a high stress zone that's going to radiate a lot of high frequency energy, for example. So here's a site, and this the dashed lines here show the surface projection of that actual rupture surface. Right above the hypocenter is the epicenter. So one distance measure that you might use is the epicentral distance. It's the horizontal distance from the site to the epicenter. Another one would be the hypocentral distance. It was the slant distance down into the earth. Whoops, I didn't intend to do that. And another measure could be the distance to the asperity or the high stress zone, or the closest distance to the rupture surface itself, or the closest distance to the horizontal projection of the rupture surface to the surface. It turns out that the two measures that almost everybody is using now are the slant distance to the rupture surface, the closest distance, called RRUP, and RJB, which is the closest distance to the horizontal projection of that rupture surface. Now, whatever distance measure you choose, you have to realize that you have to be able to use this to predict motions in future earthquakes, where you may not know where the hypocenter is. You may not know where a location of a high-frequency radiator, an asperity on the fault would be. So you have to have some measure that allows you to just use the overall geometry of where you think the earthquake's going to occur and then come up with a distance measure. The measures that are commonly used, as I said, are RRUP and RJB, which turns out to be zero when you're over a fault. So that's the distance measure. So we have the magnitude, the distance. What about the site geology? You probably all know that if you're in a base, if you're right down, well, right here, you're kind of on a hill, right? So it's probably not going to have a lot of resonance of local soft sediments. But if you get down near the waterfront, particularly near an estuary, you can get soft clays and so on that can amplify the motion. So you have to account for this in your equations in a fairly simple way. You could always do a site-specific amplification calculation, but for these equations I'm talking about, they're intended to be used in a broad spectrum of types of sites. So we can't just do a site-specific everywhere we want to use those equations. So this is kind of a crummy slide, but I think you can see it. This is it's simply a plot of the one-second spectral amplitudes as a function of observation number. So the horizontal axis means nothing other than just the observation number. And distance and magnitude effects have been taken out. So you can see there's a tremendous scatter to this data right here. And if you then separate those into two groups, one to rock and one soil, in a very simplistic way of characterizing a site, you can see that the soil sites in red are systematically higher, even though there's still a very large scatter, than the rock sites, which are in blue. So people for years, I mean hundreds of years, have known that soft soil sites will amplify motions more than rock sites. Now, we can do better than that. And so the first thing people used for years was the rock soil classification. Now we have something called the NEHRP, or National Earthquake Hazard Reduction Program site classes. These are based on the average shear wave velocity of the sediments or of the material down to 30 meters depth. And in these site classes, they're just groups. So if it's 180 to 360, it's site class D. If it's 360 to 760, it's site class C, and so on. You might wonder why 30 meters. Well, that's because at the U.S. Geological Survey, where I work, a little bit before my time, they were doing a lot of these measurements, and they only had enough money to drill a hole to 30 meters in one day. So that's what they used. And it turns out that it's not a bad measure. So that's one thing. You can just take the sites, and even if you don't have an actual measurement, you can often you can estimate, based on the local geology, what the site class would be. And then you can do better than that if you do know the shear wave velocity by using it as a continuous variable in your equations. And then finally, something that is only slowly getting into these ground motion prediction equations now is some measure of the resonant period of a site, because the equations I'm going to be talking about today are completely blind to that. If a site has a very strong resonance at some period, that's not incorporated into the equations. This just shows that VS30 does make a difference in amplification. This is a plot of amplification on a log scale versus VS30 on a log scale for response spectra of 0.1 seconds, so a short period response spectra. Distance and magnitude effects have been removed, so you can see there is definitely a trend right here, so that you have more amplification for the soft sites than you do for the hard sites. There's still a lot of scatter. If you go to a long period oscillator, a longer period, 2 seconds, you can see there's a much stronger dependence. Now, this is a fairly limited data set that Bill Joyner and I worked on many years ago, but the more modern data are in agreement, general agreement with this. I've already talked about why we use VS30, but I do want to say that if you had shear wave velocity profiles in the Earth too arbitrarily deep, that would be wonderful, because then you could compute an average shear wave velocity down to a depth that was consistent with the period of motion that you're interested in. We just don't have that much data down to depth. But the good news is that where we do have data, it seems like there's a pretty strong correlation in general between the shear wave velocity average to some depth z greater than 30 and the shear wave velocity average to 30 meters depth. And that's shown here for two different averaging depths. So 100 meters here, 600 meters here, much greater. So this is the average shear wave velocity versus VS30, and every symbol represents motions of a velocity profile at a specific location. And the green is from Japan, the blue is from California. It's kind of hard to see, but the little stars there are from Turkey, and then other parts of Europe are here. So you can see that there is a pretty good correlation right here. This is a one-to-one line right here, by the way. And even when you go to 600 meters, now there we don't have any data except in Japan that goes down to that depth, but you can still see that there's a significant correlation. So on average, we can use a VS30 as a proxy for, or as a surrogate for average velocities to even greater depths. Now I want to show a specific example from an earthquake that occurred in Alaska in 2002. It was a pretty large earthquake, 7.9. It occurred on the Denali Fault, way up here. But it was well recorded in Anchorage, right here, and that's what I want to concentrate on. I want to show you how VS30 really does show up, or the ground motion amplitudes differ for different VS30s. This is a map of the stations. They're all nice digital recorders. And this is the red are NEHRP site class D. As you get closer and closer to the water, you get softer sediments, finer grain sediments, and you have lower shear wave velocities. These are the mountains right here. We have one station there. And then between the mountains and the soft stuff, you have, there's a transition of a CD and then a C right here. Those are in the blue. So we have a lot of recordings. And I'm going to show, I think the next picture is going to show seismograms from K220, which is as close to the water as you can get, as far away from the Chugach Mountains. And then K216, which is right here, which is in the mountains themselves. So the left-hand panel here shows K220, which is the one close to the water. This is acceleration as a person of time versus time for an east-west component of motion. This is the mountain station, K216. You can see that you can't see a lot of detail, of course, but you can see the amplitudes are much lower. But if you then go, if you integrate this twice, is a simple way of emphasizing the longer period motions. The blue shows the results of that. And now you can see that they're looking much more similar. There are some pulses in here. The amplitudes still are a bit different. But if you then filter out the high frequencies to really emphasize the long periods, then you get the red traces for these two. You can see they're very, very similar. And this just shows that the VS30 is going to affect different periods in different ways. And in this case, long periods are going to be almost not affected at all by the different local site geology, whereas the high frequencies are going to be much more affected. And to show this in more detail, you can simply take all the stations that were in site class D, for example, and just average their amplitudes and plot those as a function of frequency. And you do that for the transition class CD and then class C, and then you have this one class B site in the mountains. And you can see a very distinct differences here. And if we take, say, the site class C, which is a common one, as the reference condition, then we can see that we have significant amplification on the soft sediments over a factor of two over a very wide range of frequencies right here. So clearly VS30 is a very good, it captures these differences of site amplification. Then you can make maps, and this is done for different frequencies, 0.2 hertz down to 14 hertz, the high frequencies right here, and you can see that there are significant differences in the predicted amplification at those different sites. Now, I've told you about the details of what it is we're trying to predict, what are the predictor variables that we're using. Let's get into some of the ground motion prediction equations themselves. The title of the talk is Past, Present, and Future. And I only have one slide for the past, and that is due to John Douglas. And on this axis right here, we have the number of ground motion prediction equations for predicting peak acceleration as a function of publication date. And the blue is a cumulative curve right here. So you can see that at the time this was cut off in about 2011, the cumulative, there was 350 equations that had been published after that time that John Douglas could find. So there's a lot of equations. But now if you take each one of those equations and you use it to predict the ground motion that equation would give you for a specific magnitude and a specific distance, this is what you get. This is peak acceleration, and actually there was a smaller set of response vector equations, and this is 1 second right here, as a function of publication date. And what really strikes you when you look at this is the scatter. Now, each one of these dots represents the predicted ground motion for a magnitude 6 at 20 kilometers from a specific ground motion prediction equations, one person's or one team's publication. You can see there's a tremendous amount of scatter, and it's not decreasing as a function of time. Because of that, the question is, if you want to predict motion someplace, which ground motion prediction equation or set of equations are you going to use to predict those motions? There's a lot of uncertainty, which we call epistemic uncertainty, in the ground motion predictions. As a result of that, the Pacific Earthquake Engineering Research Center in Berkeley, California, came up with a project called the NGA Project, Next Generation Attenuation Project, to try to decrease the epistemic uncertainty and that's what I'm primarily going to talk about in terms of for a good part of this lecture right now. This NGA stands for Next Generation Attenuation Relations, and I could go into some detail of how I think that's a poor term. And now ground motion prediction equation seems to have caught on. The way it worked is there were developer teams, and there were five of them. I was on one of the teams. And then there were supporting working groups, which looked into many aspects of what might be put into the equations. The developer teams, this is actually the latest. We had two, so far there's been publications based on two versions of the project. The first one was published in 2008, the second in 2014, which we call NGA West 2. And these are the teams for 2014. A lot of these names may be familiar to you if you're familiar with engineering seismology. And usually the equations go by the initials of the developing teams. I should say this was an amazing project for me because I was pretty intimidated when I first started because of all these famous people here. But what I found was it was an amazing collegial exercise. We would get together in small groups, a small conference room, much smaller than this, and people would show their results. And nobody was trying to defend their territory. Nobody was trying to cut down somebody else and say, mine are better than yours. It was just an amazingly supportive group. And so it was a tremendous experience for me. we all use the same database, and the database development was a huge effort and was extremely important because they had the people who were developing the database for every single earthquake and had to make sure they got the best measure of earthquake magnitude, the best representation of the rupture surface so they can compute distances. They had to process the data in a uniform way. They did all that work, and it took a tremendous amount of time. I mean, it took like, they thought it was going to be done in a year. It took 3 years or so. In this particular NGA West 2 project, we're only coming up with equations for predicting motions in active tectonic regions where the earthquakes are primarily less than 20 kilometers deep. We're not dealing with subduction zone or stable continental regions. Those are separate projects in PIER. Just to give you an idea of the data that we had available to us, this is a very standard plot where if you have a recording of a given magnitude, let's say that one, it's because of the parallax, I can't really see, it's like 4.3 maybe, and a distance less than 1 kilometer. You simply plot it on this graph. And so you do this for every recording you have in your database, and it gives you a very good rough, a very quick idea of where you have a lot of data and where you don't have a lot of data. These are the data that were available to us in the NGA West 2 project. We had over 21,000 three-component recordings for more than 600 earthquakes for active crustal regions. Now, I've simply shown by the red here the distance and magnitude range that is probably most important for engineering. This is a magnitude is greater than 5, distance is less than about 200 or 300, 200 in this case. Notice that we really don't have a lot of data in close to big earthquakes in here. So that's what I was referring to before, where some of the simulations may be needed to fill in that data gap. Now, in contrast, this is the same plot for a stable continental region, in particular eastern North America, because there's another NGA project dealing with what they call it NGA East, coming up with equations here, where now almost all the data is outside of this region of engineering interest, magnitude and distance region. That means that we cannot use the standard regression fitting equations to data to come up with equations that we can use because we simply don't have data in the regions that are of most importance. For that reason, we are using a lot of simulations in that region for this project right here. So there's a distinct difference in regions in the world with the kind of data that you have available to you. It's always important when you have a big data set before you fit any equations to it, to simply look at the data and just see what the magnitude, what the data is doing in terms of magnitude dependence and distance dependence and so on. So I've done that. I've taken, these arrows do work. I've taken the data for the NGA West project. I've have done one adjustment. I've adjusted it to 760 meters a second. I'm only looking at strikes of earthquakes. And I'm plotting data here, short period data, 0.2 seconds, response vector as a function of distance. And by the color codes are different magnitude ranges. So it's 3 to 4, all the way up to 7 to 8. And this is a 6 second oscillator, so it's quite a longer period oscillator. You can see that if you read down here, we have many fewer data for a 6 second oscillator, 3,000 some odd points. And that's because of noise problems in the recordings. But you can see there's some distinct trends in here, and there's also some real differences between the 0.2 and the 6 second oscillators. Let's look at some of those trends. The first thing to notice is that there are a tremendous amount of scatter in here, even with this data. So I'm simply showing here the data for, what is this? It's probably the 4 to 5 right in here, and this is the 7 to 8. So you can see that there's a large amount of scatter, and it's larger for the small magnitudes from the bigger magnitudes. So this is something we would have to capture in the equations. The reason for doing this is to decide if the functions that you're going to be fitting to the data can capture these effects that you know exist. Another thing that you can see is if you look in at close distances, that the motions tend to bend over, they tend to saturate, they become distance independent, at least when you use the RJB as the distance measure right here. And not only that, there's a suggestion that that the magnitude that as you get in close, that the ground motions from different magnitudes don't vary very much, so they tend to saturate as well. If you want to look at the magnitude saturation and get away from this close distance problem, let's look at the data in a magnitude, a distance range around 50 kilometers right here for these two oscillator periods. And if you do that, you get this. So here you can see that there's a very strong dependence of the ground motion data with magnitude up to about magnitude, I don't know, 5.5 or 6, where it tends to roll over. And then once you get to the really large earthquakes, there is very little magnitude dependence. If you look at the 6-second oscillator, however, now there's a bit of a rollover, but it's not nearly as obvious. So there isn't that kind of saturation. Again, these are these trends that we have to have, the equations have to fit. And finally, the distance attenuation is going to be different for different magnitudes. And also, it's not just a simple, if this is a log versus log plot, it's not just a simple line like this. But clearly, the data show that there's a rollover as you get to greater distances. So we have to have equations that can capture all of these different things right here. And the equations that that we used in 1994, in the BGF-94, were very simple. We had a simple quadratic as a function of magnitude, and we had one distance term that was a log r, which would correspond, log y and log r correspond to a straight line, because we're only, in this case, we only had data out to 80 kilometers, and so we didn't need to capture that rollover. And then there's one site dependence here, which is the average shear wave velocity. So very simple. Let's look at the equations for NGA West 2, and I don't expect you to look at the equations, of course, but it's just much, much more complicated. We have the log of y is a function, there's a function of magnitude and distance and fault type and so on, and each one of these functions can be very complicated, like the magnitude dependence is in 4 sections rather than just one quadratic, it's 4 different segments. So that's because people looked at the kind of plots I showed before and they saw there were these dependencies and therefore they felt they had to come up with equations that could capture those trends. So we need these complicated equations because we have to make predictions from a magnitude range from 3 up to 8.5, distances out to 300, and so on. There's a very wide range of these predictor or explanatory variables that we need. The equations have to be valid for. The ones that I'm associated with, which is BSSA-14, that's Boore, Stewart, Shahan, and Atkinson, they're probably the simplest equations, but even they look complicated if you write them down. The trade-off, or the price you pay for the simplicity, is that they're probably regions where they should not be used. And for example, we know that over a dipping fault, they probably give you some biased results. This simply shows our equations on the same plot of data that I showed before. And so it shows you where we're capturing many of these effects. There's stronger scaling at long periods of magnitude than there is at short periods. We have this tendency to roll over. We have the saturation in close, and so on. Just a few very simple kind of coarse comparisons between the various developer teams and their equations. This is for peak acceleration. It's for magnitude 7. Strike slip fault for a reference rock condition of 760 meters a second is a function of distance. You can see they're all fairly similar, although don't be fooled. There's a log scale right here, so that actually hides a lot of things, differences. This is the magnitude scaling that we have. This is for a 30-kilometer distance strike slip fault. We're making the predictions of peak acceleration against magnitude. And you can, again, see that they all have this this turnover, but it's done in different ways. Some people have just one simple break right here. Other people have a quadratic. Other people have different, it's hard to see from this plot, but different segments in there. Something that is very important, and I'm not going to dwell on in much detail here because it's because it gets pretty complicated, but that is, I was showing up here just the median predictions of ground motion, but it's the uncertainty that's really important in hazard maps in addition to the median. And we have to consider the total uncertainty is what really we put into the calculations of the hazard curves that go into the hazard maps. But that total uncertainty is made up of two kinds of things, earthquake to earthquake, or we call it inter-event uncertainty, and within earthquake or intra-event uncertainty. You can imagine that if you had these green symbols here are data points from earthquake number one, and you've removed distance and magnitude effects, and you're looking at residuals relative to some equation. You can see earthquake number one, all the motions may be high relative to your mean prediction, and earthquake number two might be all low. This is natural variability from one earthquake to another because things like the stress drop of the earthquake may be different for the same magnitude. So that that variability that given by this eta, this red right here, is a measure of the earthquake to earthquake uncertainty. But if you remove that and then look at the scatter, that's called the within earthquake variability. And so when we do these analyses, we have to consider the two kinds of variability. Kind of a complicated picture, but this is actually showing the total uncertainty and the earthquake to earthquake and within earthquake uncertainty, comparing the work that we did in the first NGA project, Boore Atkinson 08 and BSSA 14 right here. Just look at the total uncertainty right here. It's given by the thick curves. And in red is the most recent one, BSSA 14. And then the older one is given by the blue. First of all, of course, the total uncertainty is greater than the two components of that. Sorry for flipping this back. The other thing you often find is the earthquake-to-earthquake variability given by the dotted lines is actually is the least important component of variability. But just getting back to the total uncertainty, you can see that it increases generally with period, and it has not gotten smaller in general. Even though we have much more data than we had before, a lot of careful analysis was done. This is a measure of kind of the basic random standard deviation of ground motion that we're not going to be able to reduce given the equations that we're using. I want to say a few words about vertical component motions because even though horizontal component is the most important, sometimes vertical component is important. We've done another analysis in this NGA project continuing on the horizontal motion where we've looked at vertical component data. I'm not going to go into any details, but I'll simply say that we certainly see some differences between the horizontal and vertical, and the best way of showing that is simply take the ratios of vertical to horizontal for, in this case, it's for a distance of 10 kilometers as a function of period for magnitude 7 and different VS30s. So in the magenta line, this horizontal line is 2/3, which is a rule of thumb that engineers have used for many years, that the vertical motion is generally 2/3 the horizontal motion. Well, you can see that on average, if you're in close to the earthquake, but certainly if you go to short period motions at close distances, the vertical motion can actually be greater than the horizontal motion. If you look at 70 kilometers right here, you can see that rule of thumb is not very good at all. Almost all of the vertical component is almost always less than the rule of thumb would tell you. You can also see when you go to the longer periods that the sensitivity of the ratio to the shear wave velocity is more important as you go to longer periods. And that's because as I was saying before, the waves refract, they come up into the sediments, and there's more dependence on the horizontal component of those sediments than on the vertical component at long periods. Now, what about if we have situations where we have some data, but not a lot of data, not enough to actually fit to these equations? And there are some parts of the world that I've been involved in where this is the case. What we can use is something called residual analysis. We'll take the log of an observed motion, we'll subtract the log of the predicted motion from some equation, and then we'll look for overall biases. We'll plot those residuals as a function of various things and to see if we have to modify those the equations. This is work that I've done in Greece. It's a Greek data set. We're still working on it. And the top graph shows the residuals as a function of magnitude of the earthquake. And this is relative to the BSSA 14 equations, the NGA equations. And in the magenta are the averages over different magnitude bins. And you can see that overall, it's pretty good. It means that the data from Greece, the magnitude dependence is quite similar to that from the global database used in the NGA project. Against distance, it's also pretty good. Against VS30, well, it's okay in here, but you can see there's some distinct differences when you go to lower velocities. One thing that we did find was a big difference, though, was that there's an overall bias to the Greek data, such that the Greek data in general are lower amplitude than the data that we had in our global database. And this overall bias is shown in this plot, where this zero right here would mean no bias. You can see the bias is a fairly strong function of period. So as you go to longer periods, the bias tends to get smaller. When you go to the short periods, it's quite large. And we think this may be because many of these recordings were made in the ground level of fairly, masonry buildings that were fairly stiff and fairly heavy. And we think that there's a building or a soil foundation interaction effect here that's producing this bias. Now, to bring this back to New Zealand, this is work that Brendan Bradley published actually before the Christchurch earthquakes. And I'm simply showing, he has a figure with where he's plotting these residuals against many different predictor variables. In this case, I'm just pulling out the one that showed the largest dependence, and that is the distance within the Taupo volcanic zone. So this is relative to the Boore-Atkinson 08, the earlier NGA model. And you can see there's a very strong bias right here, so that the farther the waves propagate through that volcanic zone, the smaller the motions are. So this is clearly a place where our equations, the BA08 equations, would have to be adjusted to account for this. So let me talk about the future peer work right here. We're in the NGA West project, vertical components, well, we've done that. We're adding directivity. I haven't talked about that, but if a rupture starts here and it heads that way, generally energy gets focused in the forward direction. That's not included in most of the equations at this point. Then there's the NGA East project, which is for stable continental regions. It's just wrapping up right now. Reports are just being finalized. The equations have been done. Then there's the subduction. And that is really in the early stages of the database development. And that's turning out to be a huge job. And it's also turning out that the equations that we're going to have to use, there are a lot of effects that aren't going to be captured in the simple equations we're using in the West, for example. The hope would be that as you get more earthquake recordings, we can fill in some of these data gaps we have. This is NGA West 1 data that was for 1 second period and 10 second period. And you can see there's a lot of white space in here. In this case, I've redefined this close-in distance range. It's greater than magnitude 6, distance is less than 10. When we go to the 2014 NGA West 2, we have the cyan points. Well, we have an awful lot of added points for small magnitudes, but very little added data in this region right here, which is a critical region. So that's telling you that as you get more and more recordings, they're probably going to be from smallish earthquakes, not big earthquakes, and it may be a long time before we can fill in these regions. Here's an example. We had a couple earthquakes in California in 2014. And this is the data. This is where the data fell in this plot. This right here, the yellow, is more than 400 records, but it just barely made it into this critical region right here. And that's the reason I think that in order to really have some idea of what's going on in here, we're going to have to use simulations, and that's going to require very sophisticated computer programs and wave propagation modeling, where you tie it in with the existing data to make sure your models are good, and then predicting data in here, and then using those in developing the future equations. Let me talk about how these are used. Spaced out here. This is how simulated motions can be used. It's as I just said, supplement the observed data. But they're also being used right now to show us how the equations should be, how we represent hanging wall effects, saturation, directivity, and nonlinear soil response. Let's turn now to how these are used in building codes. I'm going to give you an example of how a hazard curve is constructed. But the basic idea in a building code is that for any given site, you find the response spectra, in any given period of response spectra, and for most building, many building codes now use two periods, 0.2 and 1 second. And the specification is what response spectral amplitude has a 2% chance of being exceeded in 50 years. This is where ground motion prediction equations are used. Once you make those computations, you can make a map of the resulting values. Those are hazard maps. And then there's usually a committee of engineers that gets together, and they turn the hazard maps into design maps. So it's a kind of a lengthy process, but where the seismologists are generally involved are in these first two steps right here. Why 0.2 and 1 second when we know that buildings can have, you know, huge range of resonant periods? Well, it's because you can actually construct, and the hazard in the building codes tell you how to do this. If you had those two response spectra, those two periods, the building codes tell you how to construct a response spectra from which you can get the response amplitudes at any period. So those two periods are generally the critical periods for doing a hazard map. How are hazard maps, how are hazard curves actually computed? You have to consider where the earthquakes are going to occur relative to your site. It could be a specific fault where you know the magnitude of the earthquake. It could be just a zone where you could have an earthquake any place randomly located in the zone. You have to know how big the earthquakes might occur in those sites, in those regions. You have to know how frequently they occur. So this is the seismic source characterization of the process. Then once you consider a specific earthquake at a specific distance from your site, then you use the ground motion prediction equations, and you predict what the ground acceleration is going to be as a function of distance. And you combine those two into a hazard curve, which is a statement of the annual probability of some ground motion measure being exceeded as a function of that ground motion measure. And I want to go into some detail over the very simple case to show you how the hazard curve is actually constructed. Let's consider a site right here where we have only 10 kilometers away a source A, which is a small earthquake, 5.5. Let's assume that it occurs every 10 years, so the return period is 10 years. That means that it has a probability of being occurring of 0.1 in a given year. Let's also consider another source at 50 kilometers away. It's a much larger earthquake, 7.5. And generally, the larger earthquakes have a longer return period, in this case, 200 years. So it has a 0.005 probability of being exceeded or of occurring in a given year. Now, let's just consider the source A, the small one. And we'll predict the ground motions from, this is from my equations. And this is the response spectra at 1 second period for magnitude 5.5, because that's the size of the earthquake. And the curves would say, well, okay, this is the median curve. It has a 50% probability of being exceeded. This is the median plus 1 sigma, so it's 16% of being exceeded. Median minus 1 sigma, so it's 84% of being exceeded. Now, the actual site was only 10 kilometers away. So if you plot here at 10 kilometers, then you can pick off, these are the motions that we predict for that magnitude earthquake at that distance. Now, we know that the earthquake has a 0.1 probability of occurring. We also know that for the median ground motion, we know that for this level right here of 0.088G, there's a 16% probability of being exceeded. So the total frequency of exceedance would be 0.1 times 0.16, or 0.16. Well, what you need to do is plot that now on this plot. So this is the frequency of exceedance per year, and that's the combination of the probability of the earthquake occurring, the probability of the ground motion being exceeded, versus the amplitude of the ground motion. If you do that for all, for that one source, for all possible ground motion values, not just the median minus or median plus one sigma, then you come up with a blue curve right here. So this is called a hazard curve. If you do that for the other site, the other source, this is source B, that's the red, you come up with that hazard curve. You see, it's a much larger earthquake, but it's farther away. It occurs much less frequently, so it has a much lower, the motions from that source have a lower frequency of being, probability of being exceeded in a given year. But to construct a hazard curve, you take these kinds of curves for every individual source, and you add them all together for a given ground motion level. And that's the sum right there. Then somebody has to tell you, well, I'm interested in constructing a map for, in this case, 2% probability of being exceeded in 50 years, which is this magenta curve. So you just run over here and you pick out from the black curve what the ground motion level is going to be. So this is the level of ground motion that you'd use in a map for a specific site. And you do this for all the sites in the region of interest, and you finally make a contour map. So this is for the whole United States. It's using that same process. And in this case, it's 0.2 second spectral acceleration and 2% probability of being exceeded in 50 years. So you can see, when you look at this, we know this is San Andreas Fault, so clearly it lights up. These are the New Madrid earthquakes in 1811, 1812, which were very large. This is Charleston. So there's some sense to this, but you could go to any site now in the United States, and you could use this as the basis for a design map. I'm going to show you a little more detail about how you can deconstruct these to get some more insight into what magnitudes and distances are controlling the hazard. This is a lecture I gave in Davis right here, and so this is where it occurs, and these are the maps for California. You can see it's a little bit out of that red zone because the San Andreas Fault is over in here, and so Davis is out in the Central Valley. But then we can do something called a deaggregation. Now, it looks like kind of a complicated plot, but basically, you're asking the question of earthquakes of what magnitude and what distance are contributing to that overall hazard. And each vertical bar is a bar plotted for a given magnitude. In this case, say magnitude 6 at a distance of 10 kilometers has this bar right here. So when you look at this, you're saying, okay, 0.2 second period at Davis, we can see that most of the hazard is being contributed by earthquakes that are within maybe 30 or 40 kilometers right here, in magnitudes between about 6 and maybe 7, something like that. You can do the, you can make a map now, the same thing, 0.2 seconds, and you can now look at Davis and you can see, where are those earthquakes occurring? Well, this is the San Andreas Fault right here. These are the faults that are in the east side of the bay, the Hayward, Calaveras, Rogers Creeks faults. You can see they're contributing almost nothing to the hazard at Davis for this short period, 0.2 seconds. If you look at a longer period, and the scales have changed right here, you can see that now we're getting at 1 second period, we're getting a lot of contribution from earthquakes that are over 300 kilometers away, and I have a terrible thumb here. Yeah, they're over 300 kilometers away. And now, if we look at the map, we can see that the San Andreas Fault is now contributing a fair amount of the hazard, as well as these faults we have here, which are actually subduction earthquakes off the coast of California. Now, as a contrast, I want to show a similar picture for a site in the middle and eastern part of the United States. This is Oberlin, Ohio. My daughter was in the geology program as an undergraduate there, and I went back and gave a lecture. So I constructed a similar picture. The scales are different, the horizontal scales, the magnitude and distance, than I was showing before. In this case, we have 4.5 up to 8, and we have distances up to 800 kilometers. You can see that almost all the hazards is concentrated for fairly small earthquakes at fairly close distances. This is because in Oberlin, Ohio, it's not exactly earthquake country, and there are no known faults that are contributing, like the San Andreas Fault or the Alpine Fault in the South Island here. In contrast, let's look at 1 second period. Again, we find that there's a very distinct difference, so I'm going to go back in the pattern right here, between the 0.2 second deaggregation and the 1 second deaggregation. And now we have these earthquakes that are in the New Madrid region contributing, the very large earthquakes, 7.5 to 8, contributing most of the hazards. So they're a long way away. And if you make a map of the deaggregation right here, this is Oberlin. And you can see that all these randomly, sort of the random sources, background sources, are contributing very little, whereas most of the action is contributed by these earthquakes way out there along the Mississippi River. Now, there's a sort of a personal story here I can tell you about. I was a graduate student at MIT, which is in Massachusetts. It's over about right here. In 1968, my wife and I were living in a married student apartment on the 12th floor of a 14-story building. And all of a sudden, we noticed that the skyline was going like that. And we had a Japanese lantern, you know, bamboo and paper like this, and it was starting to swing back and forth. We had a little sink full of dishwater, and it was like a mini seiche, you know, that you often get in earthquakes. So all this stuff was going on. We thought, what's going on? And well, these are the days before internet. We didn't have a telephone, nothing, no access to the outside world. But I went to a party that night, and some of the other graduate students said, did you hear about the earthquake in Illinois? This is in 1968. Well, Illinois is somewhere around, I just lost the laser pointer, but the Illinois is actually to the west of Oberlin right there, and I was way out there. So I was actually feeling in a 14-story building, so the resonant period is like 1 second, 1.4 seconds. I was feeling these very long period motions from an earthquake that was a very long way away. So it's very similar situation to what I'm showing you here for Oberlin. So a few very quick final remarks. I hope I've given you some insight into how these equations are constructed, what goes into them, and why they're important, how they're being used. And there are a lot of students here. If anybody, or if you're a seismologist, you're interested in simulated ground motions, I do think this is an important thing for the future, is to use simulations in a number of different ways to improve these ground motion prediction equations. So thanks very much.
Sure. David, for such a wonderful talk. Do we have any questions from the audience by chance?
I'd like to ask a question. I'd probably like to ask lots, but
just got one. I have no place to go until Saturday, so
you showed plots of the different NGA West equations on a log, like you said, you've got quite some log scale. And then when you generated the hazard map, you spoke about how the uncertainty.
That's a great question, and I'm not prepared to answer that. I haven't seen those. I know that the hazard maps are being done at the USGS in Golden, Colorado, and Mark Peterson and his group, and he's made those comparisons. But I should have put those in, but I don't know what they are. It's going to depend on the period, probably to some extent. I think overall they're not that different, but I could be wrong.
That's
go ahead. Yeah, I those plots I made, you know, I to be honest, I didn't have a program that evaluated all the NGA West 2 equations, so I couldn't make better plots. I apologize for that. The NGA West 1, I could have made much better plots. So even though I pulled those from Yusef Borzonia, who was the head of the project, and if you really look carefully at the log scale, you see there are certainly important uncertainties in that.
There's no question. Oh no, there's one from Liam. Yeah.
Do you have any comment on the quality, I guess, of the VS30 measurements?
You know, that depends very much on how they're measured. as you probably know, since you asked the question, you know, there's invasive measures where you have a borehole and you stick a seismometer down and you have some active source at the surface. There are measurements that are non-invasive that are use a spread where you have a source and then a line of seismometers and you record, say, surface wave dispersion and you invert for that. There are a number of different methods, and I have been involved, and there have been a number of these kinds of projects where we're doing blind comparisons of the results at a given site. We did one that we published. It was in San Jose, California, and we had many people who had different methods who volunteered their services that came out to this one site. We did have a borehole. They sent me the results. They didn't know what the borehole results were, so I could do a true blind comparison. And actually, the comparison was very good. I was quite surprised. But it was a fairly simple site because it was well away from the mountain front, fairly flat-lying materials. The velocities didn't increase very rapidly with depth. We did some comparisons up for some sites closer to the hills where it's a much more difficult proposition. But overall, it actually worked pretty well. The other thing is that if you look at the coefficients in the equations and how the ground motions depend on VS30, they're not that sensitive to the VS30. So that I think that the variability in VS30 is not a crucial factor.
Well, I might take the achievement prerogative to ask one more question.
Sure.
You say the future is using simulated ground motion to fill in the gaps in order for us to get a better estimate of the hazard. How do you decide the weighting you put on using simulated ground motion and existing records?
That has to be determined, because it's just at the stage now where they've had a number of projects. For example, at the Southern California Earthquake Center, they had a big project they called the Broadband Platform Project, where they had a number of different people who had what they call broadband simulation measures. So they're using the stochastic measure. That's a whole other topic, but I've been very involved in predicting ground motion, simulating at high frequencies, which is basically using a stochastic method. And then you combine that with real wave propagation studies where you have a model of the crustal structure. Then you combine the two together. Those are broadband methods. So they had this very lengthy, in-depth project where they had a number of teams, and they came together and they tried to be as specific as possible about the kinds of faults that they wanted them to rupture, a model. They had a basic data set that they were trying to match and so on. So they did all this work to try to develop confidence in these methods. When you look at that, there's still a lot of variability depending on the periods and the methods. So at this point, we're still developing confidence in the methods. So it's a little bit too early, I think, to know how to weight those relative to the data. But certainly one thing you'd do is you would make predictions in that magnitude distance plot where you do have data, and you would see how well those predictions, how well you're predicting the existing data. Then that would give you confidence if you're predicting very well in using your predictions at closer distances. But that's still work that's undergoing at this point. Okay, say it again, please.
Through Quake Core, which is a New Zealand-wide research program that started at the start of this year, one of the main focuses is ground motion simulation, and Brendan Bradley at the University of Canterbury is leading that. So.
Oh, that's right, and Mark Sterling is involved in that as well, down in Dunedin, at Otago. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I gave this talk at both of those places, and so I got a little bit of the background there. That's really good. So I think you're going to find more and more teams starting to do those comparisons and looking into the methods. I can tell you right now, though, one of the problems is going to be at high frequencies, which are really most of interest to engineers, it's knowing the crustal structure well enough, because the wavelengths involved are fairly short. And so there's all kinds of scattering and complicated effects that these nice, simple, plain layer models of the Earth just aren't going to capture. And I know Brendan showed me some very impressive results from some of the Christchurch data that he has, where he was able to model the high frequencies. I had never seen anything that was that good before at high frequencies.
Well, So we might just get everyone to join me to say thank you for David for such a formative lecture, and thank you very much.
And thank you for inviting me.